due to introduce Kunal Borse, so he is one of, so he was the main guy, I should say. I mean, the first person to actually come out and say we need a group or we need a club for people interested in this kind of theoretical stuff, mathematics and recreational mathematics club. So he thought, okay, maybe we should create a group so that people can come together and discuss like this. So then Arnab created a Facebook group, and then people came together and we three met, and then it happened. So yeah, Kunal, can you please introduce yourself?
Yeah, so hello everyone, good evening. I'm Kunal Borse. I'm a fourth year undergraduate and I'm from MS Hall. Like, you people haven't been to campus, so I think I don't know whether Hall should be mentioned in the introduction, but still. Yeah, so as Madhu said, we were in our second years, and we had this feeling that everybody was, you know, doing this ML and coding. Those stuff is also good, but we felt that there was a need for some club for people who love mathematics, right? So we came together and we thought of this, and I hope you'll enjoy this session on geometry that we have today. So let's go ahead with it.
So overview today, we're going to cover, you know, some stuff. Will recall our high school knowledge of geometry, Euclidean geometry and other geometries, how geometry is everywhere, foundations and other kinds of geometry, modern geometry, and then applications, right? So maybe every time we'll start up with a, you know, warm-up puzzle. So Patricia P has three boyfriends. Yeah, and name them, say Alan A, Bob B and Carl C. So what she's trying to do, she's trying to find a spot that is minimizing the overall distance from all these friends. So basically, she wants to stay close to all of this together. So it's the sum of distances. She wants to minimize this. So where should she land? Geometrically, what is the position?
This is the Fermat's point, like A, angle APB, all the angles should be 120 at P. That would be the point.
Yeah, so, right. So there is a point. So of course, there exists such a point. So it is called Fermat's point, and you can characterize it by, you know, basically all these angles, you know, APB and PC, all these three should be 120 degrees. That is a point that actually minimizes the total sum. That is fine, you know that, but can you prove it?
There are two ways, one by rotation and other using physics. Like, I know two of them. The physics one is quite simple. Like, we can imagine, we can imagine that this is a triangular table, and at point A, there is a mass of 1 kg hanging, and at point C also, and at point B also. There are three mass of 1 kg hanging.
Oh. Right. Exactly. So how do you prove that? So is a very excellent proof using physics, actually, as I told. So imagine three weights, all of 1 kg each, and you create a thread that joins all these weights of say equal length, say 1 meter each, and then you okay, let us say you have three pulleys at A, B and C, and you pass these blocks like this, and you release the system. So what can I say about the equilibrium point? So the weights will go down, they will balance and they will find a spot. So what can we say about that? Using the physics we know, what can we say? The weights will go as down as possible, right, together. So what I'm saying is, the red string, the purple string and the blue string that are hanging, the sum of these will be maximum. So potential energy is minimized, right, in any equilibrium, global equilibrium. So these weights will balance so that the sum of these strings, red, purple and blue, is maximized, which means the sum of PA plus PB plus PC is minimized, because the total length is 1113 each, and if you subtract the hanging thread from 3, you get this. Since the hanging thread is maximized, the sum of PA, PB, and PC is minimized. So that is a point we want. So this is a, okay, say this is a very nice way to compute it. Like, you don't want to do calculation, you just hang some blocks and you will find the point. But what is the characterization of the point? You can see these three forces are equal because the weights are equal, right? It's 10 newtons each. So when do three forces balance? When do three forces balance? Equal forces. Can you say anything?
When they're at 120 degree each with respect to
they have to form an equilateral triangle basically. So when you put them head to tail each, so looking at the right figure, you can say that angle APB, BPC and CPA is 120. So this is the Fermat point. So it's a very nice proof using physics. There is a problem. Suppose angle A is greater than 120, then P goes outside the triangle. So that condition you have to mention. If angle A is more than 120, then P does not, the Fermat point is not the answer. It is something, some other point in the inside.
Then it is that angle, that point where it is greater than 120.
No. I don't think so. I think the point has to be inside. It's a different boundary condition. I think it will be on the boundary of the triangle, possibly at point A or point B or point C. It won't be the Fermat triangle, I think.
Perpendicular from one to other, from obtuse angle one to bigger side.
Figure that out, what happens when A is greater than 120. So another puzzle, so I'll let you think. So this is suggested by Kunal. So we have a semicircle and there is a point P. These are two walls, this is a floor and this is a wall, and the semicircle is sliding on this wall. What is the locus of P? How does P move? Is the question clear? So we have a semicircular object, a wall and floor, and this is sliding. So this moves, this point moves to the left and this moves to the down or direction. And what is the locus of point B? Maybe another question could be, what is the locus of the center of the circle? That is easy. What is the locus of the center of the circle? Can anyone say that?
Ellipse hota hai shayad.
Center, this one, this midpoint of this.
It's a quarter circle. Well, the locus will be a quarter circle.
Yes. Quarter circle. Why is that? Why is it a quarter circle?
Because it lies on the circle, the point.
No. So you're answering which question? Whether of locus of P or locus of the midpoint of this hypotenuse?
The corner lies on a circle.
Which corner?
This down left.
For the midpoint of the semicircle, it will be a quarter circle.
Yeah, why?
We can take a line joining the origin and that center.
Yeah, right.
We can say this line has the same length throughout the sliding.
Yeah, so basically, if you know this theorem, the median line joining origin and the midpoint of hypotenuse has length half of the hypotenuse, because this is a semicircle and this is the diameter and this will be a point on the circle.
region.
Right, so the locus of that point will be a quarter circle.
Take like this length is, the length is x and y, and take use equation of locus.
Right.
So the distance is equal to the radius of the semicircle itself.
Yes, yes. Yeah. So that's why it will be a quarter circle. So that is fine, but what is the locus of P? I'll give you one more minute. Can you guess at least? If not prove, but what do you think P moves like?
Vertical.
Yeah, you can have guesses.
Straight line.
Straight line, that's true. So why it is a straight line if you ask? So this is 90 degrees and this is 90 degrees. See, if you look at OAPB, it's a cyclic quadrilateral. So what is a cyclic quadrilateral? Something that can be inscribed in a circle. And it, when can we decide if a quadrilateral is cyclic? When the opposite angles sum up to 180. So 90 plus 90 is 180. So that proves that OAPB is cyclic. And since, you know, look at the chord AP, its substance angle, the same angle as ABP. Like angle AB, if you think, if you let ABP as alpha, then AOP is also alpha. And but alpha is a fixed angle, right? So it's a fixed point in the semicircle. So the angle made by AP at B is fixed. So which means P makes the constant angle with respect to origin when you take base OA. So P basically moves along this line. So that's nice, right?
Can you explain it again? Like, how is ABP constant angle? I didn't get.
Right. So wait. How can I arise? Yeah. So first of all, basically, so. Do you know what is a cyclic quadrilateral?
Yeah, yeah.
Right. Cyclic quadrilateral means.
Actually, your voice is breaking.
P makes the same angle.
Madhu, your voice is breaking, actually. Just 1 second, I'll contact him and let him know. 1 second.
Am I audible?
Yeah, yeah, you're not audible.
Yes.
Oh, fine. Sorry. Yeah. I think this puzzle is fine. So since alpha is fixed, P moves along OP, right? So it's a straight line.
Okay.
So that is fine. So we'll move to basically, so we start with the history of geometry. How did it start? And this guy, how did he revolutionize, say, geometry? So Euclid of Alexandria is known as father of geometry. And so what is geometry? Geometry basically means earth measurement. So why did people want to measure stuff? Right, so I think there is a story that goes like this. So Egyptian people who lived near Nile. So every time when there is a flooding, so the area that is flooded, they wanted to calculate, and then So this kind of wanting to calculate stuff, area and stuff basically gave rise to this area. So yeah, so people wanted to measure the height of some building or something, but you cannot go and measure it, right? You cannot put a scale or something, but how do you measure it? So you can use geometry and similarities, you know. There are tools to measure, basically just if you know the angle subtending from your eye to the top of the building, then you can and if you know the distance to the building, then you can you know, calculate the height of the building. So because of this practicality, there was a demand for geometry, so people started studying geometry, right? So this guy wrote a book called Euclid's Elements. So it is a series of 13 books that lay the foundations of geometry, which he called Euclidean geometry today. Right, so he basically gave 5 postulates. So let it have him postulated to draw a straight line from any point to point. So what he's saying, you give me 2 points, then there is a line passing through them. That is fine. And to produce a finite line continuously. So you give me any finite line segment, I can extend it in both directions infinitely. So he's basically establishing the unbounded nature of the plane, and to draw a circle with any center and radius. So he's saying, okay, give me any center and any radius, then I can draw a circle. And postulate 4 says all right angles are equal to one another. So all 90 degrees, there is no different 90 degrees. So 90 degrees is the same. Okay, there is no 90 degrees. It's a quarter rotation, we have to say. So 90 is just a number. So the point is it's 1/4 of a complete rotation. So it's the same thing everywhere. And fifth one is very interesting. It's called the parallel postulate, which basically says that it's 5 is an equivalent formulation of this one. So simply put, it says you give me any point and any line, and the point not on the line, there will exist a unique parallel line through the point. So basically, you give me a line and a point above the line, then there is only one parallel line through the point to the line. So it seems fine, right? But many mathematicians started to question 5, or whether if it can be derived from the other postulates, and if some started questioning whether, you know, what if we ignore 5 and change it, it gives to new geometries. So 5 actually is this, and it gives rise to Euclidean geometry. Interestingly, you change and say you give me any point and any line, there will be infinite number of parallel lines. Then it gives us something called hyperbolic geometry. And if you say none, so you give me a point, there won't be any parallel lines going through this point. It gives us something called elliptic geometry. So we'll see soon what we mean by hyperbolic and elliptic geometries. So, okay, I'll ask again, am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible.
Okay. So, geometry is everywhere. Where is it? So, let us watch a video. So, the question is, why does a string when placed on soap film automatically unfold into a circle? So, we'll see what I mean. So, can you see the video?
Yeah.
Right, so it created a soap film. And so he took a closed loop thread. And he creates a hole. So it immediately becomes a circle. Why is that happening?
Due to minimize the surface area energy, and it will be minimal at while it will be a circle.
So effectively what you're saying is the isoperimetric theorem, which claims among all planar shapes with the same perimeter, circle has the largest area.
Largest area.
Right. So why? Why is that? So why do you think it's true? We know circle as the shape that you take a point and you basically trace the locus of all the equidistant points. We know that as a circle. And how come it's popping up here? How come it is the figure with maximum area with the given perimeter? So basically, I give you a loop of thread and I tell you to maximize the area, then it is when it is a circle. Why is that? Like, I know that you know the result, but did you ever think of why, wondering why it's true? Can I prove it?
Can we say it's something similar to like the AMGM type inequality, something like the quantity tends to be maximized when a particular, like if the three multi quantities x1, x2, x3, then x1 into x2 into x3 is maximum when all three are equal, such that the sum is constant, something like that.
Well, just because some quantity under some constraint is minimized when all of them like, are equal.
Suppose we have a shape and then we consider with respect to the center, then like circle tends to have all the points at an equal distance always.
What is the center of a figure? So I'll give you an ellipse. What is the center? I'll give some weird shape. What is the center? There is no center.
Okay.
Say you take some random origin.
Hmm.
Then actually what you're saying, I think works out. So, I mean, you have to use differential geometry or calculus. Calculus of variations. And I think, yeah, analytically it's possible to prove this result. But very simple proof. Like, did any of you even try to think of this during your +1, +2? Or, I mean,
I thought of it, but I could not get any logic, means no way to proceed to prove it. I thought of a lot of on it.
Right. Okay, at least being curious is good. Like, It is strange. It's a very simple thing, but when you ask for a proof, it turns out very complicated. But there is a proof.
Is it like infinite side polygon?
Okay, some people do this. So they take an equilateral triangle and they take a square and then they take a regular pentagon and then they take the limit of, so they fix a perimeter one unit and then they look at all these areas. They see that it's growing as the number of sides increases, and then when you have infinite sides, it's a circle. But that is not a proof, because you have to prove among all triangles, first of all, the equilateral triangle has a maximum area for given perimeter among all quadrilaterals. I mean, if you have this result that all regular polygons are the best figures, the largest area, then you can claim this result. First, you have to prove this. Like, for every fixed number of sides, you are at the top when you are looking at the regular polygons. Now you look at all the regular polygons and claim that circle is the largest. But yeah, maybe, yeah, that approach is also fine. But how will you prove that among all triangles, equilateral triangle is the one with maximum area? Maybe you can use Heron's formula and prove that, but for square, pentagon, it becomes complicated. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe you can try that. The triangle area will get maximized. That is easy to prove. Like S is fixed. Root S into S minus A into S minus B into S minus C. So if you use AMGM, then you can easily prove that it will be equal when A equal to B equal to C. That is fine. But for larger sites, it will be hard. So the proof goes like this. First of all, the curve has to be convex. Why? Like, it cannot have this dips. Why?
With the same perimeter, we can generate larger area.
Yeah.
By simply flipping it outside, you can increase the area, but with the same perimeter. So clearly it's not optimal if it's not convex. So that much we know. So that our figure is convex. Another rule, line dividing into equal arc lengths. So that said, the total perimeter is 1. Take any line that divides the perimeter equally, 1 and 1, half and half. Now I'll say that both these areas also have to be same. Like, why is that?
because if like one of them is greater, then we can say that both of the right other one should also be the previous one.
Yeah, basically if the bottom one is more than the top one, I can just take the reflection of the bottom one, then I'll have with the same perimeter half and half, I'll have a larger figure with a larger area, right? So basically any line that divides into equal perimeter should divide into equal area also. I mean, if not, if one is big and one is small, then I can take the reflection of the bigger one. Right, so basically what did we do? We did a reduction. So we have a curve of perimeter half. So it's not a complete loop. We just have points A and B and open loop of length half. Now the reduce problem is to find the shape that will maximize the area. Now we have to prove it's a semicircle. So the reduce problem to find an arc of length L by 2 with n points A and B lying anywhere on a straight line, such that the arc together with segment AB encloses region of maximum area. So now what I'll say, prove that you take any point, angle AOB has to be 90. How do you prove that? Like looking at the figure, it should be clear.
At the hypotenuse wish.
No, the thing is, if AOB is not 90, I can move point B to the right? So I can expand AB so that AOB will be 90 degrees. So given two fixed side lengths, AO and OB, the area will be maximized when angle O is 90 degrees, because it's, you know, maybe you can use this half formula, half AB sine C. So sine C is maximized when 1, so it's half AB when it's 90 degrees. So basically using this rule, angle AOB is 90 degrees for every O. So this has to trace a circle, semicircle, which means the overall figure is a circle. Right, that's it. No math, only logic.
I didn't get the last part. Why should area AOB be maximum, like the entire area of the semicircle has to be maximum?
See, the area, this area and this area are fixed, right? So imagine you're constructing a line AO and OB. This part of the curve won't be changed. We're trying to maximize only AOB because these two are fixed for now. So in order to maximize area of AOB, angle O should be 90 because AO and OB are fixed.
I didn't get why the other two areas are fixed.
So imagine it as a solid region, right? So you have this figure. It is a solid piece of wood. Okay, it is a solid piece of wood. So I'm cutting AO and cutting OB. So we have these two pieces, shaded pieces. Now you have a wooden piece AOB. I will replace it with a new wooden piece AOB with a larger area and stick back these two pieces. You understand what I'm doing?
No, actually, like I am not getting.
Like imagine currently you have a wooden
directly piece. As a circle. AO, and I think he's getting confused because he's thinking that AOB, that thing is already a circle. It can be any shape, but at the end of our argument, we proved that at each O it will be 90, then it will turn out to be a circle. Now think of it as a general shape.
Yeah, basically consider the optimal shape. And we try to use its optimality to prove certain structural properties. So what I'm saying, you consider any point and join AO and OB. Fix this, the shaded regions you cut out and put somewhere, and let us try to just maximize the AOB area. When you maximize it, angle O will be 90 degrees, and then put back these two pieces. They'll fit right in, right? Like, we didn't change anything. Yeah. We didn't change the perimeter. We didn't change AO is fixed, so it'll just come right out. I mean, it'll just come and sit on this.
Okay.
It'll fit back nicely. And now we increase the area because O was not 90, now it was 90, so the area increased.
Okay, I got it, yeah.
So by this argument, you take any O, it should be, considering it's optimal, O cannot be less than 90. Otherwise, I can create a new figure with more area.
Yeah, so I got
the
it.
The angle subtended at every point has to be 90. And you know that it's a semicircle. And then the, from the rule to, you know, just reflect it and then you'll get circle. You used convexity and this rule and just this one. And yeah, it's very simple. But it's a very powerful, I mean, see, it's very elementary, right? If you have to prove it using calculus, say you take the origin and consider a curve and then you have line integrals, you compute the area using polar coordinates, it will be hard. You have to use some inequalities, maybe Cauchy squares. It will be very, you know, messy. But you can still prove using that stuff also, but this is a very elementary proof. You can explain it to a 7th, 8th grader, right? Who knows basic geometry? Yes, and geometry is at many places. So did you ever play with soap bubbles? I assume you all played, but see, whenever you blow some bubbles and look at these bubbles, you always look at this 120 degree intersections. They always form this kind of hexagons, or you always see this 120 degree intersection. Like there cannot be four edges at the same point. It's always three, degree three. At every point you have three edges. It's a hexagonal tiling. Why is that happening? And why do honeybees build their honeycomb hexagonally? Why not square? Why not rectangle? Like there are many tilings. So yeah, tiling of a plane. So you can tile it. So you look at your home and look at the tiles, if you have any. It's mostly square. So there are only three ways to tile a plane. So regular tilings, I mean. So every tile should look identical and all the vertices and edges should be identical. It's a symmetric shape. So the only three symmetric shapes that can tile the plane are hexagonal, triangular and square. And why is nature choosing hexagon every time? So what is nature optimizing? Can anyone guess? So does anyone know why it's always hexagonal?
I think it wants to maximize surface area. Means the area of each, I think lesser the number of hexagons.
So the point is, what is this hexagonal thing? It's wax, right? How do they build it with wax? So basically, the total perimeter is the amount of wax that, so bees are trying to optimize, basically to enclose all this honey using minimum perimeter. By perimeter, I mean all this wax content. So with minimum effort, with minimum wax, they have to build this nest. So it turns out that there is a theorem, hexagon comb theorem. So the hexagonal grid gives the best way to divide a surface into regions of equal area with the smallest total perimeter. So in essence, what it's saying is, if your house would have had hexagonal tiles, it would have taken lesser cement to tile your floor. So basically, when you tile your home, you have to join these tiles, right? And you have to put cement in the boundary of the edge, right? So the amount of cement you are using is basically the total boundary surface, the sum of all these basically. It is minimized, so among all these three, the perimeter is minimized for hexagon. So then why aren't your tiles hexagonal in your home? That will take lesser cement to join them. Why are we still using squares?
I think we will have more wastage of material if we use hexagonal. Or maybe no. It will be
no. You give me a plane and then I can. There is no wastage. It is tiling completely. There is no wastage. Right, if you give me a square initially, there will be small wastage in the boundary, but it's negligible if it is large. Point is, it's hard to manufacture, so ease of manufacture. How can you build a square? I mean, you just cut along these edges, boom, you have a lot of square tiles. And even triangle tiles, you have to make three cuts and then you have a lot of triangles. But you cannot make those edge-to-edge cuts to create hexagons, right? So it will take more effort to create hexagonal tiles. So that is the reason we choose squares. And for triangles, it will take too much cement. So the trade-off is with squares. It's very interesting. So and there are a lot of ways to tile the planar, actually. You can tile with pentagons. There are many pentagonal tilings. So tiling the plane is a very well studied area. So there are called periodic tiles, Poincare. There are many tiles, non-periodic tiles. See, it's an interesting area. You can look at tessellation and tiling. Maybe you can try to prove why this is only regular tiling possible. It's because the only angles that divide 360 are 90, 60, and 120. Other divisions just don't work. And so, how do you stack? So, if you see all these fruit cards, so how do they stack these oranges? They stack in a hexagonal. Man, like you studied solid state in chemistry, right? So you know that. So if you look at all these packing densities, I think 74% or something we have for hexagonal pack. So it is optimal. And Kepler conjectured that the best arrangement for unit spheres is this way. You have to stack them this way, hexagonal packing. Hexagonal or cubic close packing. Both of them are different, but they have the same. And it's proved using computers. So until many hundreds of years, there was no proof. And then there is a proof using computers. So, right, that's what you might think. Geometry doesn't have any applications. It has a lot of applications. Suppose you have four train stations and you have to build a network that minimizes the total rail length, and it has to connect all of them. So for those who know some computer science, it's called the Steiner tree problem. And Steiner tree problem is, and bubbles seem to compute it very nicely. So you just put the problem and as nails and two sheets a sheet of paper, and then you dip it in soap water, then the bubble formation is kind of the optimal network. If you put it in water, you'll get a bubble formation. If you follow it, then it's mostly the optimal railway network. It's pretty nice how nature computes stuff. I mean, physics and nature together kind of compute optimal stuff. How do bees know that they have to do this hexagonally? How do they know? How can they learn through evolution? Something like that. So again, geometry everywhere, even more places. What?
Exhaustion, proved by exhaustion, what does that mean?
So basically, they did some theoretical work and kind of reduced the problem to some cases. And these cases were analyzed by the computer. It's not like some kind of technique. You tell the computer the problem and it solves it. So So they did a lot of theoretical work and they boiled down the problem to few cases. And then the computer basically dealt with the cases. So I think you know the golden ratio and all these. You might have seen lots of videos about golden ratio and human structure in shells, in the golden spiral. What is the golden ratio? Basically, that piece of paper, if you fold a square and remove it, the new piece will again be similar to the original piece. So A plus B by B is B by A. So B by A is basically, A by B is basically 1.5 something, root 5 plus 1 by 2. So people use this to show that maybe that guy used golden ratio in Mona Lisa's picture, and the ratio of height to, you know, the ratio of this length and this length seem to be close to, is the golden ratio. And why, we don't know. So it has, this particular ratio has appeared in various art and architecture since thousands of years. Right, so that's what geometry is everywhere in nature, history of geometry. And so we'll now look at the foundations of geometry. This again a visualization of all the Euclid's postulates. So through every two points there is a line. And a line segment can be extended into an infinite line. And through any given point and radius, I can have a circle. All the right angles are the same. Postulate 5 originally says, if you have two lines and if I lay another line, these two lines will intersect on that side where alpha plus beta is less than 1/8. And people showed that this is equivalent to saying you have a line, you give me a point, there is a single line that is passing through this point parallel to the line. So, and I think you might have known about lines, points, parallel lines, alternate angle theorem, angles, triangles, congruence, similarity, SAS, SSS, all this high school stuff, collinear points, concurrent lines. So collinear points when three points are on a line. Concurrent lines are when three lines are passing through a point. It's kind of duality. We'll see what is duality later. Circles and transformations. And there is a lot of advanced stuff. Spiral similarity, inversion, lots of stuff. You can study geometry if you want. If you want to study books, then these are the books. Yeah, now we'll look at some beautiful stuff. So I think you know Pythagoras theorem. So can you, anyone of you, say one proof of, nice proof of Pythagoras theorem? So what ideas do we have to prove this Pythagoras theorem? Hello?
Yeah. One way was using similarity, actually.
Yeah, I think you drop the perpendicular and you have three similar triangles. Yeah. Then you just take the ratios and it'll be fine. Yeah, that is okay.
Mm-hmm.
Another proof is like putting a square inside a square and then you add up the areas and then you will get C square is A square plus B square. But the most famous proof, I think, is this one. Putting two squares and showing that I'll let you understand looking at the figure. So what is Pythagoras theorem essentially claiming? The area of this and the area of this will be equal to the area of this. In fact, it turns out if you draw up a perpendicular, this will be equal to this and this will be equal to this, and it will conclude the result, right? How can you prove that these two pink regions are of equal area?
We can also use Ptolemy's theorem, right?
Ptolemy's theorem to prove Pythagoras theorem.
Yeah, I mean, I saw a video on that.
Yeah, I guess you can. But no, let's try to do some things as elementary as possible. So why is the area of this pink region and this pink region same? First of all, can you say that BFC and BAD are congruent, the same triangle? It's just a 90 degree rotation. Because you see, if you rotate BF, it becomes BA. If you rotate BC, it becomes BD. So by SAS, FC and yeah, these two triangles have to be the same. And you can see that if you move A parallel to BD, it will come to K. So the area of BDA is half the area of this rectangle. Basically, yeah, half base into height, right? So what is the height? Height is BK, base is BD. So the area of this triangle is half the area of this rectangle. And the area of this triangle, so again, half base into height, let base be this one. Height will be BA. So area of this triangle is half the area of this square. Since these two triangles are same, it means that the area of this pink region is same. So yeah, that's it. Like, I thought it's a very nice visual proof. So we look at this figure. It's nice. The areas of these two are nicely getting their fair share from this one square. I think this is the most beautiful proof I don't know. Yeah. And there's a, there is this theorem called Morley's theorem, which says if you trisect the angles, they meet at an equilateral triangle. You can go and try, like you take any triangle and trisect these angles, and these three points will form an equilateral triangle. It's called Morley's theorem. And of course, I think you know this about Euler line. The orthocenter, the centroid, and the circumcenter, all three lie on a line. With centroid dividing H and O into 2:1 ratio. The proofs of this, there are various proofs. And there are a lot of results in basic geometry. Simon's line, Ptolemy's theorem, Sevas theorem, Miller's theorem, Pappus theorem, yeah, projective geometry stuff. So you can study if you want. So I want to ask one question, whether how many of you asked this question. So why is it that if you cut a conic, you are getting these conics? That's why you call them conics: circle, ellipse, parabola, hyperbola. So you can define them in other ways, right? Ellipse is the locus of that curve. If you take two fixed points and a thread joining them, and if you put your pen and draw, you know, total sum of length, then it's an ellipse. I'll define it like that. How come it is coming popping up here if I cut a cone?
And I think it was something parabola. like you can fit two spheres in the upper section and the lower section, one each, and then...
Yes. So there is a beautiful proof called Dandelin spheres. So which will prove this connection. Why those two are the same thing? So what I'm saying is, say you cut a cone. We don't know anything about the shape. Do one thing. Inscribe a sphere in this area, in this region, and excribe a circle, a sphere, in the bottom area, right? And what you do, so this tangent length is a fixed length, right? So this is a cone and this is another cone. So this length is fixed and this length is fixed. So what I'm saying is, this length is a fixed length, right? It's a truncated cone, what we are seeing. Sorry. This is a truncated cone. So this length is fixed. Yeah, and you see, if you see, let this point, so the point where the sphere is touching the plane and the other point where the other sphere is touching the plane, if you consider them, this blue length is a tangent from this point to the sphere, and this blue length is also a tangent. So this blue length and this blue length have to be the same. And again, from this point, the yellow length is a tangent to the other sphere. So tangent lengths are equal. Even for sphere, it works. So in a sense, the sum of these two is a constant. So as you move this, you will get that the sum of these two lengths is a fixed length. It's this. So that's a proof why we call it an ellipse. I mean, the ellipse that we know and this are the same. It's a very nice, beautiful geometric proof. If you don't understand, you can go and see. Check Dandelion spheres. So coming to non-Euclidean geometry.
I had a doubt in the previous part. So did we first define, or we defined ellipse as the sum of the lengths from two points should be equal, or we first found, or did the mathematicians first found it in the slicing a cone? Which of the two happened?
Right. So yeah, that is an interesting question. I think ellipse is a projection of a circle. That's how it came as it's a shadow of a circle. And then maybe, I think it's hard to say, because both make sense. That a point is the locus of a point. Maybe that way it came first. The locus of a point that has equal sum of distances from two points. That makes sense, but I don't know. If ellipse was that shape called a conic? Because if you're calling it a conic, then it should be because it is from a cone. So maybe you can check on that, I don't know. So coming to non-Euclidean geometry, you have to pace up. Right. As we told, if you change the fifth postulate, tweak the fifth postulate, then you give rise to two new geometries, hyperbolic and elliptic. So elliptic geometry is geometries on a sphere. Hyperbolic geometry is basically geometry on this kind of shapes. So if you take a triangle on a sphere, the sum of angles will be more than 180. So if you look at this triangle, so I'm calling it a triangle because, you know, circles are straight lines on a sphere, right? This longitude, this great circles. So this I can call a triangle, and I can call this as a straight line, not a straight line, line. So there is also this notion of geodesics and shortest path. So am I audible?
Yeah, voice got cut before.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, okay. You can see the picture. Sum of angles is less than 180. It's called negative curvature. If it's greater than 180, it's called positive curvature. And these are two different geometries. And on a plane, it's equal to 180. So it's zero curvature. So that is the reason why you cannot have a proper world map. So you cannot represent the globe properly on a piece of paper, because the geometries are essentially different. So you cannot not distort the shapes. So a triangle here is not a triangle here. So you have to distort the shapes. So that's why there is no perfect world map. And nobody is cheating us, just like that. So people used various maps for their convenience. So people who have to sail, they need direction. Direction has to be preserved. They don't care about shapes or sizes of countries. Other maps have preserved this. So there are various maps. So yeah, this is about this hyperbolic surfaces, how they look like. So Pringles is a hyperbolic surface. And so this people represent hyperbolic geometry on a sphere. It's called Poincare disk model. So this is a straight line. The lines look like curves in this geometry, but that's our representation. If you are living in that space, then it looks like a straight line. For us, it will look like this. And this is a point, and all these are the parallel lines to this line. So you can have infinite parallel lines passing through a point parallel to a given line. And as you can see, on a sphere, it is zero. You cannot have a parallel line passing through one point. These are various art visualizations of hyperbolic geometry. And projective geometry, so interesting stuff. So one theorem I want to show is Pappus hexagon theorem. So you have two straight lines and you take three points and join them like this, crisscross. Then these three points will lie on a straight line. It's amazing, right? Like, there are no numbers, no angles. You take however you want, A, B, C, anywhere. You just join them and then these three points will be collinear. So I believe this is one way to communicate with aliens. So suppose an alien came, you cannot convey anything. Maybe they, so okay, assume. Understand, they should have done geometry.
Your voice got cut for some time, like for last 10 seconds.
Okay, so what I'm saying was a part about aliens audible.
Yeah, so, after that it got cut.
Yeah. So what I'm saying is, if an alien civilization that is very smart can see, should have done geometry.
Voice is like breaking again.
And there is no other way you can convey stuff, like, right? You can, I mean, other stuff don't make sense because they're constructs. We constructed them. This is the universal truth. If they are living in a Euclidean space, then this should be true. And could it is you, understandable.
Could you repeat that alien thing again, because your voice got like broke again?
Okay. I'm audible now.
Yeah.
Hello. Fine. Yeah, what I'm saying is, this has no numbers, no metric. It's an absolute truth that anyone can see and understand, right? So this is called Pappus hexagon theorem. You can try to, it's not easy to prove using coordinate geometry. So there is a new branch of geometry called projective geometry. So it turns out it's even true for any conic. You take any conic and you take six points and crisscross. These three lie on a line. Am I audible?
Yeah.
So it's mind blowing, right? And Pascal, when he was 16 or 17, I think, discovered it, this fact. And these are very strange theorems, right? And they are very hard to prove using Euclidean geometry, but you can prove them using projective geometry. So it has its own set of axioms, and using that, you can prove this kind of stuff. And there is a similar theorem, says you inscribe any hexagon, circumscribe any hexagon, then all these three diagonals meet at a single point. It's called Briancon's theorem. Can you see a strange duality between these two? Like, it's as if you change lines to points and points to lines. And see, like, you see, there are six points, there are six lines. And you join this intersection points, you join the, like, you know, P2 is the common intersection point between these two lines. G is the common intersection point between, AB, the corresponding thing for AB, the line AB is a point P2. The corresponding for ED is a point P5. And the corresponding thing for point G is the diagonal P2, P5. And the fact that all these three are collinear, here says that all these three lines are concurrent. Three points on a line, three lines through a point. So there is some sort of strange duality happening. Like you take a theorem and replace points with lines, lines with points, collinearity with concurrency, and it turns out to be true. Like, do you understand what I'm saying? So there is a strange phenomena in geometry. You see, two points give rise to a line and two lines give rise to a point. Three points are collinear and the dual of it is three lines are concurrent. Point on a line, line through a point. So we have this, you know, yeah, even in the axiomatic level, there is a duality between points and lines. So if you replace points and lines, in the theorem, you'll get a different theorem. So Pascal's theorem and Rankine's theorem are duals of each other. And yeah, coming to the final part, applications. So why is all this stuff useful? Is it useful? Yes, it is. So Riemannian geometry and pseudo-Riemannian geometry. So these are elliptical geometries are used as mathematics in to explain general theory of relativity. So the space we live in is not Euclidean. So we live in a, I think we live in a hyperbolic space. I don't know. And so how many of you know this problem? Brachistochrone.
The cycloid part.
Right, okay, the problem is you have 2 points.
Sliding.
Yeah, right. You have to create a curve so that it slides fastest. So if I release a bead at A, it should come down to B. So it might, the curve might be a circle, the curve might be in a lot of things. Which curve minimizes? So y is a function. So f is a function of a function. So y is a curve. So you have to find that y that minimizes this integral. So this gave birth to calculus of variations. It seems Newton solved it in one night. And the solution is inverse cycloid. So AB, the curve has to be cycloid. And impossibility of squaring the cube and angle trisection. So did you, those of you who played with geometry, you know, you should have solved construction problems. Like they'll say using a straight line, using a scale and a compass, can you create a 90 degrees angle? Can you bisect a line segment? Can you trisect it? Can you do, so how many of you did that? Like geometric construction problems. Given a line segment, using a scale, ruler and a compass, you have to bisect it.
Yes.
Yeah, people have done stuff like that, right? And Greek mathematicians tried many years to construct cube root 2. Like, so, okay, one question is, can you construct square root 2?
Yes.
Yeah,
because you just create a right angle triangle, isosceles right angle triangle, and then you have root. That is fine. Can you create 1 by root 2? Can you create all sorts of stuff? You can do root 2 by 3, root 2 by root 3. Root 3 also you can do, because you do it another time with root 2 and 1, then you get root 3 as hypotenuse. So square root of any integer you can do. You can create rational numbers. 5 by 6 you can create, 6 by 7, all sorts of stuff using compass and ruler. But can you construct cube root 2? Also, can you bisect an angle? You can do that, right? Bisecting an angle.
Yeah,
bisecting an angle is also easy. But trisecting an angle, can you do?
I think it's impossible.
You cannot. It's impossible, and people proved that it's impossible. Basically, the set of operations that you do with the ruler and compass can only create numbers of the form a plus b root 2, something like that. Or you study some fields and groups, then you know it's an extension field to rationals. yeah, all sorts of stuff like that. So basically, this is a question that Greek mathematicians pondered over a lot of years, and it turned out it's not possible, and the proof of it includes some, you know, abstract algebra. You can study about fields, rings and stuff. So, and yeah, basically the point is geometry has inspired all these geometric problems, gave
your voice is getting
you know, origami. Hello?
Yeah, now it's audible. You can continue. Hello, Madhu?
Am I audible?
Yeah, you
hello.
Are.
Okay,
yes,
fine.
You are.
So coming to the end of my part. So we are at all this stuff. Right. Origami. So origami is also, you know, very nice geometric study of folding pieces of paper into nice. It's not only art, but it has found applications in packing transformation, like can you build a tent, like can you unpack a tent from a piece of you know, can you fold the tent back efficiently so that it is packable, and then can you unfold it nicely. So all these folding and unfolding problems has found applications. So yeah, origami. So I want to launch this space with this solar panel, and but you cannot send this large disk, right? You have to find a way to pack it, and you don't want to cut it into pieces, so it has to in a way fold and unfold itself efficiently, nicely. So that's a very good application. And coming to computational geometry and computer graphics, geometry is used everywhere in games, graphics, so geometry is important. Yeah, that's it. That's my part. Have fun. Thank you.
Yeah, I'll take over from here. It will be just a 10 minutes part of my part. Let me share my screen. Yeah. Oh, this model, sorry. Yeah, I'll just wrap it up in 10 minutes. So, okay. Okay, so, yeah, fine. Yeah, so till now, Madhu was discussing about geometry. So, this one small part of geometry, which is known as computational geometry, you can say, like, it's sort of regarding the computational aspects of geometry. Till now you were looking at some properties of geometry. Now suppose I want you to find something which in a way involves geometry and stuff. So this part is sort of related to that. So we'll have just a very informal introduction. Like I will not even give any definition and sort. I'll like make you feel what this area is through one problem. Okay. So what you are given is this polygon here, like here. So it's a step by step polygon, like you can say like this. So what I want to do, what I want you to do is to use some lines and divide this polygon into quadrilaterals. Okay. So the endpoints, so the vertices of the that quadrilateral should be one of the vertices of this polygon. So it should you must basically divide this polygon into some set of quadrilaterals. So can someone try? Like just one small example I can give. So So what I want you to do is this thing. Sorry for the delay. So suppose you have given some polygon like this. So what I want you to do is draw lines. Like basically you have to draw diagonals. And using diagonals, you must divide the polygon into quadrilaterals. So here you have two trapezoids basically. So like that, I want you to like tell me a very nice method. To divide this polygon into quadrilaterals. So you can try to think of your method after the session. But like since the time we are running short of time, so let me give you one of the ways. Like one of the very clever ways in which you can divide this polygon into quadrilaterals. So I hope the problem statement is clear. So interrupt me whenever you have any doubt. Okay. So first, what we do, we identify those points which are like this angle. If you can see here, it is more than 180 degrees. So identify those points. So we call such points as reflex angle. Okay, reflex points, the angle at which it is more than 180 degrees. So identify all such points. Okay, so on the left hand side you have blue points, on the right hand side you have red points. Okay, now consider you have one line here, and using that line is basically coming from top to bottom. Okay, so whenever it reaches a vertex, we do some action. So suppose it reaches here. So what we do, we look at its right side and see what is the red point which is available, like to its right, like the topmost red point. So you can see this is the topmost red point which is visible from this point. So we add an edge. Okay, after doing that, we go down. Then again we see that the point is blue, so to its right we'll see which is the red point, which is the topmost red point. Okay, and we'll connect the edge. Okay, so after doing this we'll go down and we see that the point is now red. Okay, so if the point is now red, we'll see to its left and identify which is the topmost blue point which is still available. Like by available I mean which is below this green line. Okay, so you can see this is the blue point which is available in a way, and I'll connect this, then I'll go down. So now I have to see to its right and identify a red point which is available, and this is a red point which is available, and I'll connect it, and I'll go down. And I'll repeat the process and reach the last vertex, you sort of terminate, like you are done. So this is the way you divide the polygon into quadrilaterals. So I'll just go back, I'll just show the animation properly. So I hope this cute algorithm is clear. So this is like one very small topic, you can say. So we deal with many such geometry based problem in computational geometry. So you have to develop algorithms in order to solve your geometry based problem. So that's that. This is sort of an informal introduction which I wanted you guys to see. So I hope this part was clear. So if it's not clear, please ask me.
Yeah, I had a doubt. Like in the last point should be joined to the corner, to the last blue point should be joined to the rightmost corner, because that figure isn't.
Okay. Sorry. Yeah, I forgot. Yeah. It should be joined actually. Yeah. I forgot to join it. Yeah. Thanks for pointing it out. Yeah, it should be joined. Yeah, one more line should be there.
Okay.
Join it. Yeah, and then we are done. Yeah, thanks for pointing it out. Yeah. So this is one way to solve. Like you want one way to divide it into quadrilaterals. You can divide your own other ways. So and this you can try to generalize it to some different kind of polygons. You have different kind of algorithms to do that. So this was just one cute example actually to do this. Yeah. So if you have any doubt like regarding this algorithm, you can ask me. Otherwise, we can sort of end the meeting here. Let's stop sharing.
I have a question that if we can do it for quadrilaterals, then can we do it for any other like pentagon, I mean for five-sided figures, six-sided figures inside a polygon? Can we construct that?
Just.